Welcome. Thank you for registering for the University of Maryland Global Campus October Cybersecurity Awareness Month activity. It's exciting to bring you a host of relevant cyber topics with special guests supporting cybersecurity awareness.
And I'm Dr. Neubart. Sorry.
Please stay tuned each month, Wednesdays at noon, each week, Wednesdays at noon for this month, as we cover critical topics relevant to cybersecurity awareness. My name is Dr. Lois Palin, and I am the Senior Director of the Center for Security Studies here at UMGC. Most of you know that UMGC is a center for academic excellence in cyber defense. And as such, our goal is to promote higher education and research in cyber defense and producing professionals with cyber defense expertise. So held every October, Cybersecurity Awareness Month is a collaborative effort between government, academia, and industry to raise awareness about the importance of cybersecurity and to ensure that all Americans have the resources that they need to be safer and much more secure online. UMGC and the Center for Security Studies are proud to be champions supporting this essential online safety, awareness, and education initiative. The evergreen theme is hashtag BeCyberSmart. Now more than ever, the theme empowers individuals and organizations to own their role in protecting their part in cyberspace. So join UMGC leaders and special cybersecurity industry guests each week during the month at noon for exciting and engaging webinars that include essential topics related to cybersecurity awareness. Whether you're a student, parent, teacher, professor, graduate, teleworker, we have a webinar that will provide you with the tools that you need to be hashtag cybersmart in today's world. I will post the registration link in the chat for the upcoming events. For closed captioning, use the CC feature in Zoom. And now over to our moderator and guest speaker.
Hi, I'm Dr. Helen Barker, and welcome to the talk with Dr. Jason Pittman. I've known Dr. Pittman, known Jason for over 10 years, and it's always exciting to participate and attend talks that he's presenting. I hope that you will find Jason as engaging as I do and the team that supports him. Jason, you're on.
Thank you, Dr. Barker, and thank you, Dr. Palin. And of course, thank you everybody for attending today. I feel like that opening, whilst very gracious, is certainly tempting the whammies. I'm very glad I don't have a tech demo, lest the tech gods strike us down. But this is one of the most exciting topics that at least I have in my portfolio, which is cybersecurity for AI. Not AI for cyber. But before we get into that, let's set a little bit about me. I'm going to tell you this not to get up on my podium of authority, but to give you a sense of where I'm coming from. My background's a little different. I have a long career in tech, full-time. I did about 20 years, and I still do some consulting here. There are special projects really to extend my portfolio and work with friends and do cool stuff. I've been in academia full-time for 10 years. I've taught at small schools, bigger schools, private, public. I love teaching. What's there to say? Where I came from is an undergrad in English literature and biology. That's a double. Now, when I went to undergrad in the mid-90s, the school I went to was small and private. We didn't have double majors. We didn't have specializations. You kind of could get a minor, but I did enough biology before I switched to English literature that I just finished the class, one class, and there's a double degree. But that background will give me a different view of things than a traditional computer scientist, which I became a computer scientist, cybersecurity, network security, information assurance person much later in life, after I had done my first tech startup. So that's my background. And please, at any time, if you want to know anything more about me, put it in chat. I'll give you my email address at the end. You're always welcome to email me questions. And at any time during this talk, if you want to engage, just drop it in chat. And if I don't happen to pick it up, our dutiful moderator, Dr. Helen Barker, will assist me in getting that information answered and addressed. So now, on to the heart of the matter. What are we doing here? Well, again, I want to be very clear about this. What I'm interested in is cybersecurity for artificial intelligence, not AI for cyber. Now, as you may know, there's a lot of AI deployed in a lot of different verticals, cybersecurity, particularly around data ingestion, alert management, log management, and decision-making is already deployed, and that's not going to stop. It's going to increase as our portfolio of technologies accelerate. I'm going to give you two views. I'm going to spend a bulk of the time we have together focusing on what I'll say are current trends and threats, why we might need cyber for AI. But at the end, I'm going to give you a hint and some clues as to what I see past this cutting edge that we're already on. And it's a precarious blade edge that we're dancing. And we'll probably get into some future speculation. I think that speculation is founded at least epistemically in sound logic, but you'll be the judge of that, I hope. So I like interaction. I hope you do too. So if you go to that URL, you will be able to respond to a poll. And I'm going to get the results on my screen. And we'll see, do you think artificial intelligence, as it exists right now, needs cybersecurity? And I'll give us a few seconds. And we'll see who thinks yes, who thinks no, who thinks maybe, and who's going to say they don't know. And I'll be honest with you, I'm kind of excited to see how many people say I don't know, because that means you've come to the right presentation. Okay. The results are coming in. This is fantastic use of technology, isn't it, my friends? So we have some yeses. We have some decreasing maybes. Come on, I don't know, people. Be honest. Be honest. How about if I tell you, while we wrap this part up, that I don't know? Would you be shocked? See, now we have some honest participants. So we have a good amount, the most amount, 82% saying yes, artificial intelligence needs cybersecurity. We have an equal amount of maybes and I don't knows. Now, this is what's interesting. Live results. This is better than Price is Right. There are no knows. So everybody either recognizes that there's a gap in your understanding of cyber applying to AI, and those are two things we'll treat independently, and then we'll get into the convergence of them, or they don't know, which is kind of a good place to be in. For those that are yes, feel free to fact check me. So I'm gonna not make any assumptions about our collective knowledge. I'd rather approach this, because I'm conceptually and theoretically driven, by defining some terms. So we're all kind of on the same sheet of music as we move forward. Thank you for your participation, by the way. Excellent. See, we can do this without even being in person. I love it. So what is cybersecurity? Because the nomenclature around this has changed. I started as network security, then it became information assurance, and now it's cybersecurity. And that's just within Department of Defense. That's one way to define it. Everybody has their little idea of what cyber is and what it entails. So again, conceptual definitions now. I'm going to tell you that I think cybersecurity, at least in the context of how it's going to potentially apply to AI, the AI we have currently and in the future, is geared towards protecting assets from harm. Now, you can tell I have an information assurance background because that's a pure IA definition. Protect how? You can say, well, confidentiality, availability, integrity. Let's just say we're going to use technology to safeguard assets. Well, what are assets? In this case, what we're talking about are AI systems. We have to include the full stack. That's the hardware up through the operating system into user land, including the algorithms, the adjacent API services, and the expression of what that AI is doing. We'll call that performance or behavior. And that's really important. There's nothing like that in our portfolio of technologies worldwide. Nothing behaves the way AI does except for AI. which conceptually makes sense. Can we agree on that? AI is AI because it acts like AI. What if it doesn't? We'll get to that later. What about harm? This is where AI is somewhat different. I think you'll come to agree as we move through this interaction today. The harm that AI has the potential to have done to it and to cause to itself and its adjacent systems is substantially different than what we've experienced, let's say, in traditional non-AI computing stacks. So that gets us into what's the domain of operation. Let's call this our boundary. This is why I actually like the term cyber or cybersecurity, because it comes from a root term, cybernetics, or if you prefer the French, cybernétique. And so the study of cybernetics, although we tend to think of cyborgs and the convergence or merging of silicon or silicon-like and carbon-based life forms, that's not what cybernetics, strictly speaking, is as a field of study. What cybernetics entails is the study of systems, often very complex systems, very often systems within systems, and systems interlinked with other systems. This is systems thinking writ large in its original form. That's primarily the zone of proximal development for AI. AI is extremely good, even in its current nascent form, of quickly sprawling into a complex system that's interlinked with adjacent systems. We'll talk maybe a little bit about neural networks, and you can quickly extrapolate out neural networks that we have already. If you look at like the GPT family of generative algorithms, they're very complex just in the interlinking of network nodes, we can call them neurons, within that neural network. Now, I'm going to make a statement. You can tell me if you agree or disagree. I don't have a poll for this one, but I should have thought ahead. Without data and information, which I'll define information as processed data, there are no AI systems. We would have the algorithms, but they're absolutely functionless, worthless, and purpose, just without purpose. All AI is driven through volumes, massive volumes of data as input and output information in some form, whether that's a decision, an action, a behavior, a categorization or classification, or even, you may not be aware of this, very powerful prediction systems. This is a good way to conceptualize this cybernetic or systems interlinking integration. And at the heart of it, conceptually, this is exactly how all AI systems function. We ship volumes of data in. You might be familiar with this as a term, training data or training data sets. It's not all training per se, but that's one manifestation of it. And we put that as input into system A. System A is an AI system. Funny enough, this is exactly how computation works fundamentally. That system A processes the input and produces output. Now, this is what makes AI systems insanely powerful, is they can feed that output back into themselves as input. It's a feedback loop. This is where you can get into the differences between feed forward and back propagation and different techniques to train AI systems and have them quote unquote learn. We'll talk about that a little later. The other thing you can do, and this can be done concurrently, it can be done linearly, it can be done at some point in the future, is that output can be used as input to an adjacent system, let's call it system B. Now, this is also a very rudimentary threat model, because what we'll start talking about when we get to the cybersecurity piece and how it might apply to AI, keep that simple diagram in mind, because we have to understand where our threat space exists within this operational boundary that we've defined. Now, let's talk about AI. And as I bring this up, again, you'll go to the same link. I'll activate it in a second. And if you have questions, please feel free, jump in. We don't have to wait until the end. So I would like to know what you think artificial intelligence is. Now, this is a little different. I'm not giving you bounded yes, no, maybe, I don't know answers. I want you to type in what you think, short phrases. You can type as much as you want. And I'm going to capture what the most prominent via a word cloud terms are. do you think artificial intelligence is intelligence? Do you think it's fake intelligence? Do you think it's real? These are some interesting responses. Data collection, that's a good idea. That brings up a good question while we're waiting here for a few seconds. Oh, that's a good idea. Intelligence modeled after the human brain. Now, remember that thought, because later on we'll talk about some epistemic flaws in how we as humans perceive AI. And one of those flaws, I'll give the call ahead, is that we assume that AI has to be human-like. Now, it happens to be modeled that way because, well, we're humans creating it, right? That makes sense. Decisions, analysis, mimic. Well, that's good. Mimic human sentience. Now, this is interesting. You can actually differentiate between the terms. I told you up front I'm an English person, so words and semantics matter to me. There's a difference between sentience and sapience. Complex. Oh, this is excellent. Excellent work. Rule-based. Yes, it's a system. And all systems function according to rules. Now, as you're typing some more, I won't deactivate this yet, so I'll give you some time to put some more information into the word cloud. We can ask, does artificial intelligence exist right now? And we ought to be aware of the fact that, yes, it does. And yes, it's very powerful already, even in its, what we'll say, limited form. It does all of our navigation. If you're using any type of GPS system, I'm a big fan of Google Maps. I don't like Apple Maps. I don't like Apple devices, so I have Android. It's funny because you can actually black box test the savviness of the artificial intelligence. When my wife and I go somewhere, she'll use her phone, an Apple phone and Apple Maps, and I'll use my Android with Google Maps. And there's a stark difference. I don't know if you know this, but a long time ago, Google bought a company called Waze, and they had a very advanced algorithm for navigation. And I think, at least in my opinion, that's what drives that difference. Yeah, the music algorithms, ranking algorithms. How about our virtual assistants? I use my virtual assistant constantly to help me answer simple questions, give me definitions without having to look it up so I don't take my hands off the keyboard. Make appointments, cancel appointments sometimes, right? Our shipping and our distribution, look at the shipping and distribution problem we're having. Have you seen all the cargo ships off the West Coast just sitting there? Marketing, how about marketing? Interesting use of AI. Yeah, these are great ideas. Software that's able to learn, I like that. Now, what all those systems and most of what we could come up with as a group, and there's 55 of us in here, which is a good sized group, we could come up with a lot of ideas given enough time, right? Actually, almost all of it implements a more specific type of AI called machine learning. So there's different types of AI. Another one, because like virtual assistants are machine learning base, but they also use natural language processing. That's another form of AI. It's its own distinct subfield of study, let's say. A lot of what I'm going to focus on is machine learning. It just happens to be the most prevalent. It's the most useful to us as humans. It gives us the biggest bang for our buck in terms of AI. That doesn't mean it's the best, and it doesn't mean that it doesn't need cyber. Think about that. So machine learning fundamentally has two types. Okay, so you have AI, and then you have machine learning, and the machine learning has two types. We can roughly categorize those as categorization or classification algorithms, and then the other type are regression or prediction algorithms. So, really easy to keep straight. If I have unstructured data that I want to structure, that is, I want to categorize it or classify it, I use a classifier algorithm. If I have structure or ranked or ordered or sorted data in some way, and I want to make a decision, or even more broadly, a prediction based on that data against an unknown data set, then I use a regression algorithm. These are inherently statistical driven, by the way. I mean, really, machine learning is computational statistics that's automated. That's a really primitive way to define it, but you can think of it that way if you're coming from like a mathematics background or more of a pure computational science background. It's another way to access this idea. they have very broad applications. They can take very generalized data sets and distill them down into very specific, very targeted endpoints as output. Now, here's a question for us. Do you think that machine learning is intelligent? Is it real intelligent? We're all intelligent, we're all here. This is the most intelligent decision all of us have made, certainly made, all day, showing up to this webinar. Do you think machine learning, do you think AI in general is intelligent? By the way, that's 50 minus DKP for mentioning blockchain in an AI talk. How dare you? Yeah, to some extent, I would agree it is. I don't know that I don't think I would agree that it's at a human level of sapience. I don't know that it's not at the level of intelligence. And so this is where later on, when we start getting into that on the other side of the cutting edge, we get into some speculation. We'll talk about consciousness and how that manifests separately from intelligence, right? Yeah, we'll talk about transparency in our threat model shortly. These are great, great ideas and comments. Thank you so much. This makes it so much more fun. So I'm going to deactivate that poll because I'm going to have another one in a moment. This word cloud is awesome. If you guys want to see the word cloud after the conclusion of the talk and I take a short break, I'll take a screen capture of that and I'll put it out on my Twitter. I'll give you my Twitter handle at the end. Somebody remind me if I happen to forget, just in case. All right. So now we have an idea of what cyber is. We started there, right? We just want to protect assets. That is more specifically AI systems from harm. Harm being some measure of bad stuff, okay? From itself, from adjacent systems, harm to it as a system. And now we've kind of have this working lexicon of AI and then more specifically machine learning. We understand the two types a little bit. We can talk a little more through this application of cybersecurity about how those manifest. And that'll come out when we talk about some of the threats. But in applying cybersecurity to AI, how would you apply cybersecurity, or how do you think cybersecurity, given our definition, applies to AI? The poll is open. This is another bounded one. I don't remember how I created it. I think I created this one bounded. Or it might be short answer. And so, like, if you take even just the broad traditional IA approach, information assurance approach, and you say availability, confidentiality, integrity, do those things apply? And if so, how? Ethical issues, that is a hot topic. Lots and lots of work is going into the ethics of AI. Check and balances, oh, that's fantastic. Monitoring, security monitoring. All right, so with that, we need or want to monitor the AI in its, let's say, runtime performance. Adherence to compliance, nice. Yeah, I think sometimes because of how quickly we got into cloud and cloud is normalized as a computing service, we forget how much data is being generated on a daily basis. It is voluminous. I'm actually sometimes surprised that we're able, especially with our logistical nightmares right now, able to keep up with just raw disk volume, proportionate to the amount of data that's being generated, because that data is certainly not being deleted. Yeah, analyzing data and patterns for security purposes, sure. Transparency was a good idea. Think about that. All right, excellent feedback, guys. So, let me give you a little bit of shock and awe, as it were. Forget firewalls. Forget traditional security architecture, appliances, software services. Traditional cyber does not and cannot apply to AI, to the AI system itself. Why? Would you agree or disagree that in traditional computing systems, traditional technology stacks, attacks are binary? right? If we take the availability harm that was caused to Facebook this week, that's binary as I would define it. It either happened or it didn't. It's either available or it's not. Something's confidential or it's not. There's no partially confidential. Something has integrity or it doesn't have integrity. That's discrete and binary. There's not partial integrity. What do you guys think about that? With an AI system, because of the way it exists, which makes it AI, it doesn't exist on a discrete scale. It exists on a continuous scale. Yeah, I would agree, Vikram. It works or it doesn't work. Attacks. And so our traditional infrastructure providing cyber to those traditional systems is commensurately binary. It's either protecting from harm or it's not. You can't do that with these advanced systems, not in the same way. Here's a suggestion. As we work through the rest of this, let's imagine that the way that we're going to apply cyber to AI, both the current AI as well as the future AI I'll talk about at the end, is actually much more akin to social engineering. That is, we need to protect the AI from more behavioral human factor type attacks than denial of service, buffer overflows, right? The traditional vulnerability threat pairing. Okay, so remember the diagram. Remember the diagram. Our fundamental threat model is focused on inputs into the AI system, the AI system as an algorithm, and then the implementation of those two things in a discrete traditional system, because we don't have a way to run AI without traditional computing infrastructure. That doesn't exist yet. More so, this is a great clarification. The question is, are you saying protect the input for AI? Protect the AI during its ingestion of input, I think would be the proper way to articulate that idea. Because if we agree that AI is functionless and without purpose, if we don't give it input, we're assuming that it's going to take input somehow. And so we have to look at that space of where that data is coming in to be ingested and how that functions. This primarily, at least in the current model, works around training data, and we'll get into that. And then the implementation. So this might be somewhere where more traditional cybersecurity controls applies to the implementation. So in this way, it's like a crypto system, right? Crypto systems algorithmically are robust, right? It's in the implementation where they often become vulnerable and fail. And then the output. And the output is equally important as the input because it serves often as input back into the AI system or to an adjacent system, system B. The session is being recorded. By the way, somebody asked if the materials are being available. I'll make the slides available. I'll put a link through my Twitter. If you need it, my Twitter is at the real J Pittman, P-I-T-T-M-A-N. And I think through the university website associated with Cybersecurity Awareness Month, they'll make the recording available. That's my guess. I'm glad you're finding it wonderful. It's a good word. Thank you. So now we'll get a little more specific because we have our threat model. Just remember that diagram, right? Input, system A, processing to output, and then the output goes back into system A as further input and or goes to system B as input. And that cycle is just iterative and immortal as far as we can tell. Let's talk about some specific attacks. These exist. This is not speculation. This is not made up. This is grounded in demonstrable science. Okay? Illusions. Now, this is my term. This is the way I classify this conceptually. But essentially what we talk about with an illusion is, if I've trained a machine learning algorithm to, let's say, identify stop signs, that might be good to have in an autonomous vehicle of some kind, right? Tesla can do that now. one thing we have to grasp, and this is where this idea of intelligence comes in, is if I were to ask us as a group, how do you recognize a stop sign? I would bet, and you can give me feedback in chat. You guys are being wonderful. Thank you very much. I would bet that people say things like its shape, its color, the writing on it. We visually recognize it because as animals in the animal kingdom, we're visually driven, right? We're rigged up to see things, and that's how we generate experience. And so we learn to see a stop sign and differentiate that from, let's say, yield, right? An AI system appears to work that way if it's using a vision algorithm into a classifier, into a prediction system. That's kind of the operational loop there, right? It has to have some type of vision apparatus, sensors of some kind. It'll take that input, feed it into its algorithm. It's been trained to classify those qualities, but it doesn't see red. What it sees are pixels that represent red in their manifestation, but it sees it in hexadecimal and binary, right? Now, here's the crazy thing. If we're being honest with ourselves, I can't tell you that I don't operate that way. I can tell you that I don't think I operate that way. And that's that barrier as we move forward through the rest of this presentation between, as I would define it, intelligence and consciousness. And there's a singularity there that we have to recognize. I'm aware of being conscious and seeing that red stop sign. Yes, we're going to talk about AGI, spot on, artificial general intelligence. I'm aware of the experience of recognizing or seeing that stop sign, but I can't tell you whether or not underneath the hood, so to speak, that I'm not perceiving hexadecimal binary values. Maybe I'm a robot. I have no idea. I don't think I am. Okay. So with illusionary or illusion style attacks against machine learning, what I can do is take an AI system that is seeing the stop sign, and I can manipulate the stop sign in physical real space such that the AI, instead of identifying the underlying computational structure of that as stop sign, recognizes it as green light or not stop sign, meaning it will not stop. Now, if you're not aware of this, this has been demonstrated. The way that's done is either by putting graffiti on the stop sign in a certain way, or one of the more clever ways is putting colored tape, like black electrical tape or gray, silver, duct tape, in specific locations, specific dimensions on the stop sign. So it's not like you're covering it up. You're not putting a plastic bag over it so it can't see it. What you're doing is you're altering the underlying pixel structure, let's say, so that when the machine learning algorithm sees it, it misclassifies it. What you've done is created an illusion, just like David Copperfield made that elephant disappear. Or did he make the Statue of Liberty disappear? It's Chris Angel that made the elephant disappear. I don't know. It's black magic to us because our vision system gets fooled because we're vision oriented. The AI gets fooled because it doesn't even have that. What it has is pixel here, pixel there, this value, classify it, predict it. Does that make sense? And again, that's demonstrable in the science. That's not speculation. Now, an important distinction there is that the illusion style attacks, and there's more of them, work post-training, okay? And so what an adversary has, which by the way, could be another AI, that adversary has an understanding of how that algorithm's been trained to perform that function. And we're going to manipulate the real data coming in against that training data set to trick it or give it an illusion of something that is there that's not, or that's not there that is. Does that make sense? We can contrast that against what's called a poison attack. Poison attacks target the opposite side of that chain. Poison attacks work against training data sets. And so this is before the AI can recognize the stop sign. We're going to slightly alter, and that's very important, slightly alter things. And so you can kind of conceptualize an illusion as being discrete or binary, right? It's there when it's not supposed to be there, or it is when it's not, right? Two sides of the same coin. And that's after the AI is in place. Before the AI is in place, we can poison the training data set, okay? And what we're gonna do is because data as input ingested into the AI system is its lifeblood. Really, it's air and it's soil. It's everything to an AI. We're going to subtly skew what that AI perceives. And when I say perceive, I really mean those two types, right? Either we're going to skew what it's able to classify and or how it classifies it, or we're going to skew ever so slightly, the prediction. Okay, so do you guys remember the big hubbubaloo when Apple Maps first got reintroduced on devices, iPhones primarily? And there was these crazy stories of people charting a course somewhere and the AI, because it's an AI, guided them down the wrong path. They drove into like a lake. I remember reading that. I don't know if that's true or not, right? I mean, I would assume it could happen. That's what I'm talking about. What if you skew coordinates ever so slightly such that what should be going somewhere ends up somewhere else? That's a poison attack. That's a more straightforward poison attack. Here's what's really bad about poison attacks against machine learning, is you can actually affect the performance of the AI. And so somebody said this earlier, where performance with AI is a big concern. Has anybody ever had that effect where usually it's because of network latency, congestion, or service degradation, your navigation AI lags behind the rate at which you're traveling down the road and you miss a turn because it didn't tell you to turn soon enough? Anybody else ever have that effect? Sometimes it can be bad. If I poison the training data so that at certain times with certain internal functions during classification and or prediction, that performance chokes, you can produce profoundly harmful effects to the AI system itself, let alone to the adjacent systems that are depending on it in that interlinking or integration. That's another way that poisoning can happen. Here's a crazier thing about poisoning attacks. They're not immediate. They don't have to be. You can poison a training data set in such a way that it's like a Manchurian candidate, if you guys have ever seen those movies, the original and then the remake. I can poison it and have this harmful effect occur at some point in the future. I can have that hidden trigger only manifest when I give a certain input in real time. So let's go back to our stop sign example. Let's say I poison the training data set such that if the AI ever sees a green stop sign, it does something specific. Okay. Think of a harmful effect, but it's localized to the AI system. What if I have it go into an infinite loop such that the performance of the implementation is degraded? So like a localized denial service attack. And I know your route. And so I go to your route at some point in the future. You have no idea that the training data has been poisoned. And I paint one of the stop signs green. And now I can ambush you. Like that is a demonstrable poison attack. Yeah, this doesn't even take into account misinformation. And that engenders this whole conversation about deep fakes, which I wasn't going to talk about because that's almost a different thing, because that gets into vision and really advanced systems. But you have the right idea with that, is when you pair this stuff with a goal of manipulating, in this case, society, the effects can be, I think, profound is an understatement. Would you agree? And that's particularly what I find so necessary about developing almost, I don't want to say a new paradigm for cyber, but understanding why you can't take what exists with cyber and apply it to these AI systems, strictly speaking. Because you're not dealing with the same attacks and you're certainly not dealing with the same effects, right? Like think about like a traditional technology like data loss prevention, okay? We know how to insert a token or a watermark in a file system object, watch for that egress on a perimeter and then trigger. Works. And we've known how to do that for over 10 years. You can't do that with one of these systems because you don't know a lot of things. we'll get into a little bit later when we talk about these behavioral patterns, what's called a black box problem. And what that deals with, because that's kind of where we're going now, is this idea that you can have a perfect AI, you can have perfect input, you can have a perfect algorithm, you can have a perfect implementation, and you will never know, as far as we can tell right now, why that AI classified or predicted what it did. It cannot tell you. That is a big, big problem. And that's why you can't actually know, unless you're doing very specific things, that that data set in training has been poisoned. Does that make sense? That gets me excited. This stuff's cool, isn't it? It's very cool. So I'll give you now some ideas of how we can start to balance this, at least conceptually. Oh, remote surgery. Yeah, telemedicine. We can break that down into, I think it'd be helpful to break it down into its two subtypes, because you have classification, categorization, and you have prediction. And so there are illusion style attacks that could cause an AI. I don't know of any AI that control surgical instruments in telemedicine, but I know there are systems that A can do, and they're very, very good at diagnostic prediction, or augment control of instruments. Tell me if I'm wrong. That's my awareness. But even in those limited spaces, so if you take classification regression, think about those separately, and then we take illusion and poison and separate that, you can start to think about the ramifications. If, what if I'm a micrometer off in my distance estimation for where that scalpel is? So I can skew data, right? What if I make a kidney look like a pancreas, or a lung look like a heart, or vice versa? Those are really broad strokes, but there's no reason that you couldn't apply that. And so when we talk about mitigation strategies now, if that answers your question, George, what we can start to wrap our mind around is, okay, so if we're gonna at least reposition cyber so that it can apply in some fashion to these systems, what do we need? Well, first we need to be honest with each other and say that the controls we do have are limited, because the way these AI systems work. So our best bet in this threat model, I would argue right off the bat, is to make sure that we have proper control structures around input. Because if something happens to that input, whether it's training input or real-time input, once it gets into the AI, you're not gonna know why the AI does what it does, okay? And like I was explaining with the black box problem, that doesn't make it better in any way. That's, as much as I think it's cool that an AI can't tell you why it's doing what it's doing, I recognize that that's a severe control problem. Now, there's certain environments where it doesn't matter, right? I don't really know that I care why my navigation chooses the route that's optimal. I just want it to do it and I want to drive, right? But if I have a weapon system or I have a telemedicine rig, right, I may care a lot about why that AI chooses what it chooses, or predicts what it predicts, or classifies what it classified the way it did. And it cannot do that right now. The classic example of that is AlphaGo. If you haven't watched that documentary, watch that AI system beat the best player in the world. I don't remember, it's been a while since I saw it. And then them talk about, they have no idea why the Go AI chose that move. It was completely unexpected. And really, if you watch that, what you'll pick up on if you're studying behavior is that the only reason I would say that that system beat the human is because after that unexpected move, he got so tilted, he just couldn't play anymore. So it was very much a social engineering attack manifest. The system didn't intend that, but that's how it worked. Do AIs have emotions? What's an emotion? We'll get to that. We'll get to that. That's not rhetorical, but it's a call ahead. Integrity is paramount. So this attaches not only to the input, but to the system itself and its implementation. And then we have to figure out, we don't know how to do this right now, but I think it's going to be very important that we have some way to measure the integrity of the output. And I think if you have integrity in, integrity implemented, and integrity out, you can start to create inferences about what's going on in that AI such that we can start to at least minimize or create some transparency through that black box problem. That's the way I think about it. And then last but not least, we have to understand why these systems behave the way they do when we configure them, implement them, train them to be a certain way, so that when they deviate from that behavior, we can assess whether or not that behavior is deviant. And so that's a social structure we already have with each other. And so if we're going to run with this assumption that our AI is human-like, at least in its conception, then we ought to treat it human-like, even though it's not human. And I don't mean human rights, that's not the conversation. I'm not talking about ethics. I'm talking about if you expect it to do A and it's doing A but slightly different, that's deviant behavior. Now that gets into, do they have emotions? Can you pull the plug? Can you hit stop? Well, let's switch gears. Now we're gonna talk about the other side of this bleeding edge, because what we just went through is really at the tip of the spear of what AI is capable of and deployed doing right now. Now we're gonna talk about the future. So, last poll, if you guys wanna help out just a little more. I'll activate this momentarily. And you guys have been great, you've been patient. We've covered a lot of stuff. Your feedback's awesome. This is the last thing. Do you think we need cyber for artificial general intelligence? And so AGI is what a lot of people call conscious machines, machine intelligence, sentient AI. And this is this future that we're headed towards. Whether we get it or not, this is one of the things, particularly with cyber, that we have to be careful of. We don't want to get behind the curve on this. That'll be disastrous and potentially existentially catastrophic. We want to understand what worst case scenario is now before we get there. So let's just assume that we get sentient AI and it's awake and it's going to start making decisions in its own best interest. All right, so far, maybe I've done a good job, as the case is, because that's unanimous. It's all yes. Because you can already maybe start to envision and understand how illusion, poison, and social type engineering attacks against existing limited narrow scope AI are only going to get amplified when we have a sentient, even a semi-sentient AI. Those problems are not going away. They're going to be thousands and millions of times worse. Okay, so from the Future of Life Institute, very cool nonprofit, they've developed a set of guiding principles. I don't know that, well, that's actually a good question. Is cybersecurity considered law enforcement? Maybe it would be if we had an AI watching the AI. How do you think, what do you think about that idea? Now, we'll get into, because now what laws are going to be enforced and how do you know if those laws were violated? Okay, so here's how. We have some guiding principles. This is a subset of total list. A lot of this is ethics driven, so I've cut that out because I'm not dealing with ethics here. AI should be safe and secure. AI should be transparent. You see, we've already talked about this. We can define safe and secure if you want. Sometimes I refer to it as safe and trusted, those mean things. AI should be aligned with human values. You can also say AI should not be misaligned with human values. AI should be controllable or should be controlled. And AI, importantly, should never have the capability by itself to be lethal. That's a big deal. This is the Terminator scenario everybody gets really concerned about in pop culture. I'm going to take that list and I'm going to break it down into two pieces. These principles are pipe dreams. My opinion, this is speculation. This is not rooted in science, okay? This is rooted in theory. There is no way an AI sentient is ever going to be able to be assured to be aligned with human values. What need of human value will a sentient AI have? Think about this. These systems will be functionally immortal. They have no end in and of themselves. They're perpetuals in the strictest sense. why would they need an ethic? And if they do for themselves, why do we assume that it'd be aligned with us as humans? I think that's a deep flaw in some of our epistemic reasoning. Because they're not humans. It's really that simple, right? We have culture and we have society that enforces values, and they're not all the same. We've been in different cultures. We come from different cultures. We're not all aligned perfectly. We're just aligned at a level of abstraction that's great enough that we can create common bond and common goals. We create, I'll twist what you're saying subtly because I agree with you. We create their initial environment, but remember, they're sentient. There's nothing that stops them from creating their own environments post-awakening. And to think that we can control that, which is the next point, excellent segue, is flawed. There's no way we can control it once it's on. It will control itself. There's no turning it off. There's no pulling the plug. It's too advanced. And if we plan for that worst case scenario, we can start bringing some of these principles forward and creating new ones that we need to guard against this. I'll give you one idea as we wrap this up. We have no guarantee because of those two that AI won't be lethal to itself, to other AI, or more importantly, perhaps to us. I just assume there's no way we can guarantee it. Here's what we can guarantee. I think we can guarantee, given some special circumstances, if we start thinking about this now, that we can guarantee safe, secure trust. I think we can also guarantee transparency. How would you do it? I'll tell you how I'll do it. I think this is the way. Some people have proposed some type of firewall structure in which you, on the other side, put the AI. Here's the problem with that kind of concept. Firewalls are unidirectional in their zones, right? And so if I want to stop the AI from getting out, I also have to stop all information from leaving that environment, which means I can't interact with it, which means I can't actually guarantee it's safe and trusted, and it's not transparent. If I want transparency, I have to put a pinhole in. Well, you tell me, what attack today in our traditional infrastructure doesn't come in over some type of ingress link? All attacks come in over some type of ingress link, and it's almost all network-based. Tell me how good firewalls are. I think that's a bad concept. Here's what you do. You guys ready for some craziness? This is what you signed up for. I should get paid a lot of money for this idea, I'm telling you right now. Time. We put the sentient AI, as we're creating it, in a time-dilated bubble, such that the AI is always one step in the past relative to us, right? And now you don't need a plug, you don't need an off switch, and you have guaranteed safety and trust and security, and you have full transparency. You just have to be patient. So the idea is, because it's suspended in this time-dilated state, past relative to us, when and if it becomes hostile, we're always a step ahead. Now you have standoff distance in which you can do something. That's the trick. And that's my presentation. And it takes us just about to the end of our time together, my friends. I really appreciate your time and your interaction. Any last questions, comments, anything else you want to know, I'm happy to give you my insights, opinions, and as far as I'm aware of it, what the facts are.
So didn't I tell you he did pretty cool presentations? Technology did not fail you. And Dr. Pittman will never fail to give you his opinion.
You know, I do try to distinguish between when things are science-based and fact and when I'm speculating. So hopefully I did a good job of that for everybody.
Absolutely.
In reference to the AI emotions and consciousness, oh, this is a great question. Okay, so this is a big vision. This is the role I see that this type of sentient AI playing. Fact. Our solar system is going to die in about 4 to 6 billion years. We know that because if nothing else, the sun's going to die. And that's the death of the solar system. And I'm interested in our species surviving that event. Now, that's a very long time, but it's a guaranteed event. Unless we change something else, which requires the same scope of solar engineering as this idea does. And so in order to survive that, we need some type of space art so that we can do some type of extra solar system travel, right? We can't do it in the state we're in. My best guess is we'll have to be distilled down into some cryo-stored DNA form, which means we need something to pilot the Star Ark. I would want a semi-sentient or sentient AI to be that pilot. I want that pilot to be safe, secure, and trusted. Oh, this is a great question. Can AI detect cyber attacks before they happen? Yes, that is entirely possible. You can look at the parallels in, do you guys remember IBM Watson, the AI that played Jeopardy? That same system or modification of it, I don't remember the name of it, does medical diagnostics. And it is way more accurate than human beings at diagnosing medical ailments. It's massively better at it. That same system that can exist for like law enforcement, particularly on the judge side, not the police officer side. So the judicial system, not strictly speaking law enforcement, but in that same area. I think you can take that same type of prediction AI system and apply it to, let's say, a perimeter, as long as it has full view. We can't give it a limited view, which now means you have to trust that entire system to pretty much your entire perimeter of security. It's possible, but we have the black box problem to deal with. How would you put AI in a time delayed bubble? I don't know. My best guess is it has something to do with like a Bose-Einstein condensate, but I'm not a physicist. I just came up with the idea. Maybe we put it, I don't know. We understand time dilation. I mean, we correct for it with GPS thanks to Einstein relativity. So it's possible. I don't know how practical it would be. Great questions. Great stuff. So again, feel free to follow up with me. My Twitter is at the real J Pittman, P-I-T-T-M-A-N. You can email me at jason.pittman@umgc.edu. I'll take that word cloud in particular because I think the findings are interesting. I'll put that up on my Twitter after I take a short break when we're done here. And it's been a pleasure and honor. Thank you, Dr. Palin. Thank you, Dr. Barker. Thank you, the spirit of UMGC and participants.
Thank you. Thank you, Jason. Much appreciated to have you lead us off in our Cyber Month events. Hopefully we will see all of you next week. Have a great day. Dr. Palin, do you have any comments? No mic. Okay. No comments. All right, everybody. You have a great day. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Cheers.
Thanks again, Jason.
My pleasure and my honor. Take care, everybody. See you next week.